You're listening to The Real Fan Review with Hav, Sanj, Al, and B.
What's going on, podcasters and YouTubers? This is Hav here, one of your hosts from The Real Fan Review. Today with me, we got my boy Sanj.
Good evening, everybody. As always, it's a pleasure to be with you.
We got our man in the chair, Al.
How's it going, everybody?
And we got my brother B.
Guten Tag.
That one I know. Yeah, man. So listen, on today's episode, man, we're going to be talking about a lot of news, a lot of big news, because there's more meaning to these little bits of news here. So we got, let's start with Ms. Marvel we got going on. We have Aldous Hodge being a Hawkman in the DCEU. We have Borat 2 trailer, Kraft trailer. We also have Jamie Foxx reprising his role in Spider-Man, which is very weird. And then we also have, unfortunately, movie theaters closing up shop for this year. So let's get right into the big, big news of this week. Spider-Man Part 3 having a casting of Jamie Foxx. But not just casting Jamie Foxx, Jamie Foxx reprising his role as Electro. Crazy. So I'm not exactly sure what's going on there. If this is a bigger sign of Spider-Verse going on, Sony really intermingling their different Spider-Mans and putting in one universe there. So Al, man, I mean, when you saw this news regarding Jamie Foxx, what did you think, and what's your thought process on this?
I didn't think he was gonna be bringing back the original the same Electro. At first, when I saw, I said, oh, okay, they signed Jamie Foxx. I wonder who he's playing. And then it was the same character. I'm like, okay, I guess they're just giving him another effort, another chance to, you know, recover himself and bring some notoriety back to that character. But then I started thinking, I was like, oh, wait, wasn't he part of the Sinister Six and villains from Spider-Verse?
Yeah.
So it made sense that they would bring him back then at that point. I was like, oh, wait, they have been talking about doing the Sinister Six. So here's the Electro from there. So I just hope they do it a lot better. I mean, visually, they did a great job in the original in Spider-Man 3. But I don't think they did the character justice in Spider-Man 3, especially when you have someone like Jamie Foxx playing the character. So.
Oh, yeah. Amazing Spider-Man 2. Yeah. Amazing.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. So I hope they just give him, you know, more meat to work with in terms of the character and the role. But visually, I'm expecting a lot as well, just like from the first time they showed him.
I gotcha. And Sanj, man, I mean, from what I've read, Jamie Foxx put up a post that he had to delete instantly, saying that he's going to be reprising his role as Electro, kind of confirming it. But he said he won't be blue this time. So it might be that it's Electro. But in this universe or this multiverse, he's a different form of Electro, just still the same person. This is just weird.
they could change the color of the character, but if it's the same actor playing it, it's gonna be basically the same character. You know what I mean? Like,
just hope it's not the green suit.
I know, right? Like,
with the star face.
The star face. Yellow.
I mean, Marvel has done pretty well with casting, so they must know what they're doing. You know, I'll give it a shot. You know,
I got you.
I really don't know what to think about. I'm like, you're saying it's not the same character, but you got the same actor. Like, come on.
And Brandon, man, I mean, we loved Amazing Spider-Man 2 when we saw it in the theaters, and then it got killed online and everything, which happens to us a lot with Superman, Batman versus Superman, and all those other
Maybe
movies.
Maybe it's us.
I think it's us. But we definitely liked Amazing Spider-Man 2. We can admit that there were some corny parts to it, but there were some really, really good aspects to it. Like, the Rhino was definitely corny. But, Brandon, I mean, from that Electro, I think the only thing you said you didn't like was they made him too comic booky. But then there was parts of him that you liked as well. So what's your thoughts on Jamie Foxx?
I mean, my whole thing was like, when Amazing Spider-Man 2 came out, the first trailer was all about Electro, you know, and they kind of set him up to seem really badass. Now, I think we all kind of like agreed, like the face was kind of weird, you know, like at first. I agree that to go a different route, to change him up, because having a star face, you know, it's kind of weird. But my hopes is that if this is maybe an indication of Spider-Verse along the line, like saying, hey, this is proof that maybe someone could become the same person in a universe, or this is a, maybe they have a different outcome in different universes. I don't know if they're going to go that route in this movie. I think it's going to be the nod in this movie, because I can't see it being the focus, unless homesick means he's going to travel to a different Spideyverse, you know, in essence, which could be interesting. I just don't know if they have enough time to do it that way with this. So I'm interested to see, like,
they ain't got nothing but time right now.
No, I mean, like, in the movie. I'm hoping that, you know, Jamie Foxx did a really good job with his interpretation of Electro. I think that with this Marvel boost, like, you know, we talked about it last week with the Marvel touch, I think make him or help him act it out a little bit better and make the character appeal a lot better.
Gotcha, man. And then, Al, come back to you on this one, man. I mean, with them bringing on this Electro, whether it's the multiverse Electro or if it's Electro from the Amazing Spider-Man universe that somehow gets into MCU, are you thinking this is what leads up to the Sinister Six all of a sudden in that Spider-Man 3, or there will be a separate movie for the Sinister Six?
I hope that it's a separate movie, only because if you're going to bring on actors of the caliber of like a Jamie Foxx to play the Sinister Six,
right,
I'm hoping that means that they're going to put some meat behind the Sinister Six. I mean, because look, you had Michael Keaton playing Falcon.
Vulture.
You're bringing Jamie Foxx in to be Electro. So you're bringing weight behind these roles. It can't be one movie. You got to do it like an Avengers style. You do one at a time, build them up, give them their backstory, tell us about them, why they're evil, why they hate Spider-Man, and then do like a Sinister Six movie where they're all against them at the same time. So gotcha. I don't hope they do all of them now. I hope they like maybe hint to the others,
mm-hmm.
but focus primarily now on Electro and bring him in. Yeah.
All right. And Brandon, man, if this is the sign of the Sinister Six, do you think that they could probably bring back some other villains from the other movies? Maybe possibly Dr. Octopus or...
Mm-hmm. I mean, if this goes the Spideyverse route, we've had all the Sinister Six members. I mean, and throughout all three of these universes, we've had them. Mm-hmm. So it'd be interesting. My interest is seeing is if they bring back Mysterio.
Nah.
Because he was a member of the Sinister Six, and I mean, essentially, he was probably, if they bring Electro back here, you know, we've essentially looked at all six members and mm-hmm. throughout different movies. So this could be their way of doing it, tying it in some way. I just want to see if Mysterio comes back in some way, shape, or form, even if he's from a different Spideyverse.
Gotcha. Mm. And Sanj, man, since this all this Spider-Verse talk, do you think this is our way we get Miles Morales into the real MCU or what, man?
That would be awesome if they do that, because if they go the route of opening up the Spideyverse to the MCU, then the possibilities are endless. They can do literally anything that they want and explore any Spider-Man that they want to explore. Mm-hmm. And I'd love to have the Miles Morales story in the general MCU. That'd be great.
Yeah, same here, man. And I'm just wondering, like, is this something that we'll end up seeing Tobey Maguire back or Andrew Garfield back as those Spider-Mans? That would be freaking crazy because, you know, Garfield has at least one more movie in his contract, so technically they can get him.
No, I think that it'd be great if they planned a movie event where all the Spider-Men that we've had show up and do something, you know, like, and
yeah,
so that we can see them all soon. Because as much as we may not have liked some of the movies or we thought some of the movies can be better, I think we liked all the actors that played Spider-Man, you know.
Yeah, absolutely, you know, man.
I can't really say like I hated this actor that they had play Spider-Man or like they really shouldn't have done this, you know, with
absolutely
picking one of the actors.
Yeah, man. So I mean, we're looking forward to any more news. I mean, I personally thought we'd probably be getting the oh man, what's the guy who chases after Spider-Man? They're the Kraven. I thought we really would get Kraven the Hunter. So, you know, any type of news that we get we do get on Spider-Man, we'll definitely bring it to you guys and talk about it here on the show. Listen, if you have any comments about who we think is happening in the Spider-Man verse there or in MCU, you know, leave a comment below. Let us know what you think about what's happening. It'd be interesting to hear what you guys have to say out there. The next bit of news there is unfortunately bad news for the movie theater chains, and that is Regal is saying they're going to close up shop, something that Al and Sanjay both mentioned in the past that would be ended up happening if things started turning out for the worse. But what ended up happening actually was the MCU decided that they're going to hold off all their movies from this year and just move them over to next year when they know that they can get the crowds that they're supposed to get for their movies. Same thing goes for Fast and Furious, did that last year. And now the big one is 007 has moved their time from November to, I believe it's April now of 2021. So with Regal seeing those big blockbusters out of the way and all these movies moving out of the way until at least December, they said, you know what? There's no reason for us to be open. We're just going to close up shop because we're just shedding money. Brandon, man, what's your thoughts on Regal closing up shop? And do you think AMC and all the rest of them are next?
I mean, it's looking like the amount of people going to movie theaters now that they're open in certain states is starting to decline a lot. You know, now that Tenet has been out for a while, the interest in going to see the movie theater for most people, like we talked about this before our podcast, was like, you know, like, hey, there's not much to do. So most people have probably already seen Tenet, the people who are going to go see it. You know, I don't know if anyone's waiting anymore because there was nothing else to do a couple weeks ago. So they probably went all and saw it. So now what's the virtue to going and seeing the movie now? What's the point? You know, you saw Tenet, what else is there, you know, other than a re-release from, you know, Inception, you know, a re-release of something else, you know, is that really the motivation to go spend money?
Which you probably already own at home.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So,
and everybody has a giant TV anyway. So,
so I think with Regal closing, I think they were going to lose money anyway. So regardless if they're open or closed, they're losing the same amount of money. I think we might see within the next month AMC closing.
Gotcha, man. Sean, same thing for you, man. I mean, you kind of predicted this a long time ago when we first did our COVID podcast.
I wish I didn't. I mean, I wish I wasn't right. You know, yeah. I really want to see things start to go back to normal, but only if it's safe. And I think it's crazy that two movies, you know, 007 and a Marvel movie, they don't have that. And that's not having two movies shuts down shop. They're like, all right, we're good. Go on. Back up, you know.
Oh my goodness.
Shut the windows. Hey, you know.
Yeah. Hey man, listen, I feel bad for all the employees that work for Regal. And you know, yeah, most likely a lot of them probably got furloughed or pretty much just lost their job, you know what I mean? Because it's basically no movies, who's coming? So Al, man, what's your thoughts, man?
No, it's scary for the rest of the theaters, because if somebody on Regal's level it says, you know what, it's not profitable for us to run if these big names, because think of, like Brandon was saying, Tenet was supposed to be the litmus test for how the theaters were going to do, and totally, it struggled. Now you have the next legs that were supposed to come, which were these other big movies, 007, any of the MCU movies,
Wonder Woman.
They're not coming out this year. So why are we open? You know, so if the strong movie didn't bring that many people in, and now everybody else is running as a result to next year, why stay open? I think they're all going to probably make the same decision and close up and say, we'll just reopen next year as well, which is going to make the next domino, I think, is going to happen is a lot of these movies that don't really have any reason to wait till next year. You're going to see a lot of movies, I think, start coming out either on, you know, the POD streaming or just straight to one of the streaming services. They may, you know, they're going to have to negotiate something and just get released, because at this point,
they already lost money.
Exactly. They already lost money. There was no big demand for your movie. Try to recover something, anything you can, and just go straight to PPOD. POD. So that's what I think we're going to start seeing, a string of movies, because if your big MCU movies, you got James Bond, Wonder Woman, all those movies are pushing to 2021, and you already had movies that were projected for 2021 already coming out, and now all these movies from 2020 going into there. 2021 is going to be a congested year with all these movies coming out.
You're going to need more than three movies a month.
Yeah, kid. So unless you're a strong movie, why are you even opening if you have – because normally there's maybe one other big competitor for the weekend to get to get people in on an opening weekend. You're talking about every week there's going to be multiple movies opening in 2021.
We're going to get busy.
Yeah. Do y'all think that choosing Tenet as the movie to reopen with could have contributed to it? Because it's a big movie, and it was a highly anticipated movie. However, it's not a movie with brand recognition. And you had other options, say, you know, you have a 007 movie. You have a Marvel movie that could have been an option for that. Do you think had they done it with something with more brand recognition that it might have had a different effect? Do y'all think that? What y'all think?
I mean, I personally think that it had been an MCU movie. I don't think it would have been the same usual, you know, 800 million and up for a Marvel movie, because we still have these. Look, New York and California have never opened. You know what I'm saying? There's only certain parts right. of California that opened up, and certain parts of New Jersey that kind of opened up. But New York, we still never got theaters opened up at all. So it would still be less money that they're receiving. Tenet kind of is a brand because of the director. You know what I'm saying? Like, Christopher Nolan's movies are just because he's attached to it, people go to see it. So, I mean, it wouldn't have been as big as a test as MCU would have been, but it's still saying something that people didn't go see it. I mean, look, I think last week we were saying it was up to about almost 150 million in total for the worldwide. When that movie easily could have made 150 million that first weekend had everything been open, you know.
That should have been close to $1 billion movie. You know,
And with all the demand it had, I think it was a strong movie to use as a gauge, because even from its first preview, you had a lot of hype, a lot of talk about the movie. So if it wasn't going to be Tenet, I don't know. It would have, like Hobbs said, it would have had to be something like on an MCU level where, just to your point, just the brand was going to bring them back, because I don't think there's any standalone movie that had the kind of draw and hype and talk like what a Tenet had.
Yeah, agreed.
Yeah, man. Fair enough. Just with real quick regarding this movie's Think It Is Closing Up thing, is that making the Oscars a wash?
Right. I don't think so, because the movies have come out. There's a lot of stuff that came out on Netflix and Prime and everything. There's a lot of content that they can choose from. So I don't see why the Oscars would have to be a wash. You know, boo hoo for like Scorsese and Spielberg. Yeah, I'm sorry. Yeah. Boo hoo for them, because they don't think those are real movies, you know, coming out on Netflix and things like that. So, but hey, here we are. Because theaters are shut down, and that's our only way to get the content now, you know?
But have the Oscars said that they're going to start allowing streaming to be considered? Because right now, what is it? Invisible Man and Bad Boys for Life are your biggest moneymakers for 2020. Sonic the Hedgehog. Yeah, I think that's what – those are your top three or four or something like that?
Yeah, man, it's crazy.
So they either have to alter their criteria for what counts as a movie.
Oscars with an asterisk. Asterisk! Asterisk! Sonic wins it.
Best actor. Cyclops.
Best supporting actress, Tika Sumpter. Okay. All right. Man. All right. Thank you very much.
Yeah, man. And then let's get back into the news there. The rest of the news is not anything too crazy, but pretty crazy. We got Miss Marvel cast as Kamala Khan in the MCU. And it's being cast by a first-time actress. She's like a director or an up-and-coming person in the movie industry, but never really had a big role in a movie. And her name is Iman Vellani. So she is from Pakistan, and she has that, you know, the background that matches Kamala Khan from the comics. And you know, I don't know. A lot of people are questioning whether Marvel's making the right move here by doing this, because for the most part, they do usually get actors that are well known so that once you see them, you kind of already expect them to be amazing. But there's this unknown person. So, you know, I wanted to get your guys' take on that. I mean, Sanj, I know Chris Hemsworth was a good actor, but he wasn't as well known as he is today because of Thor. Right. What's your thoughts on them hiring someone that's not really known or in the industry or has acted in anything major, taking on a big role in the MCU?
Well, first of all, I like that they cast someone who is culturally appropriate. So, you know, hats off to Marvel for doing that, taking the time to do that, because that's been one of my big gripes for a long time in the movie industry. So I've got to give credit when they do that right. Also taking on a new face, that's I'm fine with that. They have a track record of showing that they know what they're doing when they go into casting, and we need to have fresh blood as well sometimes. You know, and this is a wonderful time to have some of that fresh blood come in and give us a different look.
Awesome, man. And then, Brandon, for you, I have Aldis Hodge from Invisible Man. He is playing our Hawkman. Brandon, what is your thought about the guy that we nominate for I'm Masculine Enough in My Own Masculinity? And I can say he's the IDE Award, Aldis Hodge.
You mean not the Awkward Boner Award? That's not what that one was.
Awkward Boner Award.
I mean, listen. I think it was like we were watching Invisible Man, and it was a scene. He was just like he put his arms down on like a counter or something. He's like, pops out like 7 feet out. I was like, yeah, that guy needs to be in the MCU or something. Like this guy's tricep went out like 7 feet that way.
Like create a character for that guy, like a new character called the tricep. You know what I mean? Like, the tricep.
I was like, my man put his hand on the counter. It was like bop, and I was like, all right, I'm seeing you one of these days.
Did it make that exact sound? Be bop, like,
bop. Once it flexed out, bop.
It pushed the other guy the scene out the screen.
Yeah,
and I think it's cool because, like, you know, it's a different take on John Carter, in a sense. Was it John Carter? Or Carter Hall. Carter Hall, I'm sorry. Carter Hall. It's a different take because he's usually a white guy. And it's, you know, depending on the route you're taking here, you're going back to Egypt. So I think that having a character of color makes it a little bit more appropriate, and I think it actually takes the story and makes it work in a way that can actually be pretty cool. My man, I already know he looks the part, you know, so give the guy some you know, like, so I actually have full faith that that's going to work out pretty well.
Awesome, man. And then, Al, man, the news for you, Al, is that we got Agent Johnson, Niobe, and the Merovingian is coming back for Matrix Part 4. What are your thoughts on having our old characters from the Matrix come back to be part of this new iteration of Matrix?
It's making me more and more excited, and more regretful that we're not getting all of the old names back to see what they can do. Yeah. I would have loved to have seen Lawrence Fishburne come back for Morpheus, and so forth. But it's even more so making me just curious what's the story going to be that you're bringing all of these same characters, because is it a new Matrix if it's all of the same characters?
Right.
Yeah. So I can't wait. I mean, I was all, you know, stuff came up and we got busy over the weekend, but I was all set to put Matrix Reloaded and I was ready to make that my weekend. Okay.
Oh my God.
Okay. So it's funny that this news broke, because that was my plan for this weekend, was to get those three movies going.
And if I'm right, I mean, Agent Johnson was he was actually manipulated into being Agent what the hell is their name? Agent Smith, right? He assimilated him, right?
Oh yeah,
Smith. He assimilated all the agents in there in the Matrix.
Yeah.
All right, man. So it's interesting to see him back, because I think the last time I remember seeing him, he got his ass kicked on top of the trailer. in Reloaded there. So it'd be great to see them back. And then we'll bring the news back to all four of us here. We have trailers for Borat 2 and also a trailer for Kraft Legacy, which is a one of those witchcraft movies from the past. There, I remember seeing those. The Craft. It was always stories about four girls or four women that came in and got this book of evil and learned how to become either witches or masters of like, I guess, how would you want to call it, voodoo?
The dark arts.
Witchcraft.
Dark arts. Yeah, man. So, I mean, I don't know if you guys got a chance to watch both of the trailers. I know when I saw both of them, I was interested in both, but more so Borat 2. And Sanj, what was the name of Borat 2 there?
Subsequent movie. Subsequent. Like, it's, I mean, the simplest name. He's like the subsequent movie. Sense. But I just don't understand how this guy keeps pulling off his pranks. You know, people have got to know by now, but...
You saw him in the trailer, right? He was walking as Borat, and people were coming up to him. He was like, Borat! Yeah. So he changed his disguise to be more like American.
It's nice.
So, Saj, man, out of the trailers there, did you enjoy one more than the other? And are you looking forward to both movies, or just one more in particular than the other?
Listen, I'm looking forward to both movies, you know, because Borat, I think, a little bit more, because right. We know what the first Borat was like. But just the fact that we don't have much coming out, I really want to, anything that comes out, I'm willing to give a look and be pleasantly surprised by something I'm not usually into.
Gotcha. And Al, for yourself, man, Borat 2 and Craft Legacy?
I mean, I'll probably end up watching both of them. Just to see the silliness that this guy does in the movie. Because again, the first one, I wasn't really into the first one, but I couldn't help but laugh at the nonsense that went on in that movie. So I'm just expecting more of the same. Yeah. And then The Craft, just to see what they do. Because I remember seeing the first one. I wasn't too crazy about the first one, but it took on quite a bit of a following from what I remember.
Yes, it did, yeah.
So just to see what they do, what made them reboot it or remake it or whatever their strategy they're doing with this one. So just to see what they go, where they go with that.
Yeah, absolutely. I'm kind of more in line with science. I'm probably going to end up seeing both, but I definitely am liking more of Borat 2 and interested in seeing that one at home here with the wife, man. That's going to be a good time, Borat. Brandon, how about yourself, man? When you saw the two trailers there, what'd you think?
I thought the Witchcraft one was cool. The Craft, sorry. I thought that one was cool. I'm definitely going to see Borat just because, like, I think I need something silly right now. Like, I feel like I've watched all these, like, drama-based movies or action movies. I need something silly. So I can't wait for Borat 2 because I feel like at some point he's going to try and, like, kidnap Trump or something like that. Like,
oh my
I feel
God.
Like that's the next step. I feel like that's the next step.
Oh, my God. We find out Borat's how he got the coronavirus.
I'm staying out of that one. Staying out of it.
Yeah, it's just the flu. Man, and listen, that's going to be the news for us for this week. And, you know, if you guys have any comments that are watching on YouTube or if you're listening on the podcast, you know, you can email us at therealfanreview@gmail.com. Let us know what you thought about any bits of those news there or which trailer or which movie are you most likely to see out of Borat 2 and The Craft. And also, if you're watching on YouTube, leave a comment below. Let us know what you thought about the news subjects we were talking about and your opinions on it. We'd love to hear them. Next, we're going to talk about the movies that we saw for this week or that we recently saw in the last couple of weeks that we think we could either recommend you to see or tell you stay away to kind of help you out on there and your movie ventures there. So this segment we always call is the movies that we've seen this week. So Saj, man, it's been a minute, man. Why don't you tell us some of the movies you've seen in the last couple of weeks there? Is there anything that you're recommending or things you're telling people to stay away from?
Well, I haven't really been watching too many movies. What I have been watching is some series. So keeping up with The Boys, I actually started watching House of Cards, and I am enjoying that thoroughly.
What is House of Cards? It's more of like the White House, or is it just politics?
Yeah, it is a political drama based where Kevin Spacey starts off as an obscure congressman, and by political maneuverings, he, you know, advances his career. I'm trying to say it all without having spoilers. I figure a lot of people have probably seen House of Cards already. But him and his wife, they team up and make political alliances and then advance their careers and and you see the inner workings of Washington and federal politics along.
How far along you got in the House of Cards?
I'm now in season three, and I got to say, it is a phenomenally acted show.
I've always heard that. And I always wanted to watch. It's on my list of things to watch, but I got so many things on my list to watch.
It is I'll tell you, it's one of those things that if you don't have time to spend on it, don't start it, because the minute you start it, you're never gonna stop letting it go to the next episode. You will sit there for hours. Want to be watching the show over and over and over, and getting to that next episode. It just has you like that. It's just intriguing like that.
All right. And how far along are you in The Boys? Are you in season two, season one?
I'm up to date. I'm up to date on the Boys. But this is kind of weird because I prefer to wait till shows are over, so that I can watch them at my pace. So I can watch 2-3 episodes. I can watch a season if I want. If get away for a weekend or something like that.
Yeah.
So I'm having to, the fact that I'm having to wait for the whole once a week format. I don't like it. I don't like that format. Anymore. It's funny how streaming has changed how we consume TV shows. But yeah, I'm really not a fan of having to wait. But
yeah, Sanchez prefers the binge.
I do. And it's not so much the binge. It's like if I have the time and I want to sit down and watch, four episodes, it's like it's very inconsistent when I have the time. I may not have the time to sit down and watch, anything for maybe 2-3 weeks from now. So at that time, all right, if it's coming out every week, mm-hmm. you'll have 2-3 episodes. But at the same time, if I had the whole thing there, I could watch a whole season, But yeah,
that's cool, man. So Sanj is definitely out there recommending the House of Cards. Boys, you recommend The Boys?
The Boys, yeah. The Star Trek cartoon, Lower Decks. Uh-huh. That has one more episode for this season. It was incredible. I loved it. And then my daughter, especially, both my kids, enjoy watching it. But my daughter loves it. She wants to watch it every day. So I love that, because it's gotten her very excited about Star Trek. Nice. So now she wants to see all the Star Trek. She's like, I want more Star Trek, Daddy. So I'm like, all right, let's go.
You love that. I caught my boy watching Toy Story Part 1 from beginning to end today. I smiled so big, dude.
Oh, wow. That must be incredible. He must have loved
it. Oh, yeah. It was great just watching him watch it, For myself, man, listen, I saw a movie that I'm going to tell you guys that you either you shouldn't watch it, or you don't rush to see it if you want to watch it. And that is a documentary called Dick Johnson is Dead.
I was going to wait for you to bring it up. I just finished watching it too. Oh my God.
I had told you guys to watch Dick Johnson is Dead because I had did a search for, 2020 documentaries and what people recommend to watch. And this one just kept popping up everywhere as this was, it was in the Sundance.
Sundance. Remember,
Brandon made fun of me for saying Sundance instead of Sundance Festival. So it was in the Sundance, and it gained some awards. And people were talking about this like it was this great documentary on, this director who was basically watching her father suffer from dementia, and just pretty much watching him go along these steps 1 year, 2 year, 3 year. And they kind of sold it as you're watching him, to kind of deteriorate, but at the same time, to kind of make fun of her father kind of passing away, she decides to put her father in situations that look like he could pass away from. So it's supposed to be this like double entendre thing where you're looking at one thing, but it also means another thing. And I got to say, when I watched it, I'm thankful to the Lord of all lords there that it was only an hour and a half, because Jesus, it was boring. And it was, some parts were a little harder to watch than others, because you are watching
some of it was awkward, just awkward.
Yeah, it's like, I get about being in the intimate details of somebody's life, but some of those things,
that's what makes it awkward.
Yeah, and you just feel like you're intruding in someone's,
I had that feeling too, where you're looking at it and you're thinking, well, this is a great home video. right? This is great for home videos. Like, I get it, dad's declining, and we're going to document just that we have some footage of him, you know, when he was lucid and being that warm, beautiful person that he is. And I will say, it seems like the dad was like a very, very warm and wonderful father, you know? So that was nice to see. But at the same time, I think it felt more like a home movie that was more for them. And, you know, like I didn't really want to be watching their private moments.
Yeah, it was a little awkward for me. I kept looking to see how much longer I had in the movie. And I was like, all right, I'm just going to push through this. I did an old owl right there. Just I'm going to push through it. I already started. So I ended up watching it, and then I tried to warn my fellas here not to watch it.
I just wanted to know. I would want to know why she wanted everyone to see her, you know, her whole movie of her dad. Like, that's basically what she did. And then she added these, you know, she tried to add in these funny ways of him dying, you know, scripting and choreographing and stuff like that. I guess to make it funny, but I just don't know why she would want to broadcast. Yeah. What she broadcast.
Yeah, like I remember there was a particular scene where I think it was Halloween, Sanj, where she was trick-or-treating with her two kids, and she brought her dad with her, and I think what ended up happening was she accidentally left her dad in somebody's house and he didn't know where he was. And I'm like,
oh wow,
why are you showing that? Like, my the dude was basically crying in the car, and I'm like, come on, man, you know. Like, but listen,
to me, that's the part where I feel like she didn't take his dignity into account or into consideration when she was putting that on the screen. I feel like, are you just doing this for the attention to try to win an award at Sundance? Like, you know, is this what you're doing by exploiting your father like that?
Exactly. So, I mean, if anybody's watching that's interested in documentaries or interested in seeing something that's different or new, I mean, again, if you come across Dick Johnson Is Dead, I personally can't recommend it. I would want you guys not to kind of watch it, but at the same time, it is out there for people to see. If you do want to see it, I won't say don't rush to go see it. You know, just, you know, watch it if you want to, but don't rush to see it. But I will tell you, I've also been watching Lovecraft Country, and I've been watching that on HBO Max. I'm a little bit behind because I didn't know about the show, and then all of a sudden I kept hearing all these things about the show, and it was showing up everywhere that, oh my god, this show is crazy, it's amazing, it's horror, it's sci-fi, it's adventure, it's a little bit of everything. And I saw the first episode, and the first episode completely like wowed me, because I was like, oh my god, I mean, I felt tension when there was tension in the screen, and I was completely invested into the characters. The second episode completely lost me, but I was also told not to give up, because after the second episode, it only gets better from there. So I will continue to watch Lovecraft Country at my own time. But I will say that the first episode is amazing. The second episode is a little wonky, a little crazy, but I keep hearing nothing but good things. So I would recommend, you know, checking it out, Lovecraft Country on HBO Max or on HBO. And, Sanjo, also, I've been watching The Boys. I'm all caught up on season two right now, and it has been absolutely bonkers. And season one is a must watch of The Boys if you're into comic books and you're over the age of 18 and 21, because that
I think we might have to up that. Like, I think you might have to be over the age of 30. Like, it's that bonkers. Like,
it is bonkers, that show, and the stuff that you see is just crazy. So I mean, but I do recommend watching it, because it is a good take on like, what if superheroes were dicks, you know, like, so. it's actually crazy, man.
Yo, Homelander scares me, bro. Like, dude, that dude just scares me.
Yeah. Well, you know who else scares me? The Deep. Well, he's just like, dude, that boy's crazy.
He's got some issues.
Some issues.
But I mean, going back to Lovecraft Country, like, I'm a little behind on that as well. Yeah. That's because that's one of the shows, but I think it's incredible. But one of the thing that strikes me about Lovecraft Country is that you know, the underlying theme of racism, with it being a horror show, and how scary and frightening the horror part of it is.
Oof.
The racism is more scary.
The racism in that movie is absolutely the most scariest. Scarier than the monsters. And
I think that's what they're trying to get across. I think that's the point that they're trying to make. And man, are they doing it well.
Sanj, my favorite part. Tell me again why they painted the White House white. And they're, as they're looking at white walls everywhere. They're like, because they wanted to cover up the burn marks. Let's get the fuck out of here. Insane, that show, man. Yeah, man. Al, man, how about yourself, man? What you been watching or what you been up to? I know we're the Real Fan Review, but I think with all this movie stuff, we're going to have to start including some TV shows up in here.
Okay. Yeah, I think we are, because I got to, after last episode, y'all made me go watch Enola Holmes. And I don't know. Now, I don't know if it's, like I said last week, I actually like Sherlock Holmes. I've watched a lot of the movies. I've read a lot of the Sherlock Holmes stories and so forth. I don't know if that allowed me to get a lot of what they were, you know, hinting at, or allowed me to enjoy a lot, some of the little, you know, subtleties about the movie, so to speak. But I actually enjoyed it. I mean, I'm not
the Brandon. We did our job, Brandon. We lowered his expectations so much. Loved it.
Don't get me wrong. I don't think it's like the greatest movie, but like to be a Netflix movie where you're like, all right, I got nothing to do, let me throw on Netflix. Right. It was a good movie. I enjoyed it. I got all, like I said, I knew that Mycroft was going to be the asshole that neither of them liked. I knew that, like, there were certain things that I was expecting, and it came across, and they did it, you know, they did it differently than the others, but you still knew that Mycroft was going to be the asshole. He was going to be the one in government, you know, with the power and the prestige, especially being obviously the older brother. But
hey, also just I'm the older brother.
But no, but back Brandon's then, like, yes. Like, there was a lot more that came just by being the older brother.
Yeah.
So, and then, like you said, like you were saying in your observation of the movie, you know, seeing what she had to go through just because she was a woman, you know, being expected to go through female, I guess, training on how to be, how to laugh, how to eat, how to talk, how to.
Right.
It was just ridiculous. Yeah. But, and I think, I think Henry Cavill did a good job at Sherlock Holmes, you know, so he didn't come off too much in one direction, but he didn't come off totally oblivious as well. So it'll be interesting to see if they do a sequel to this or a follow-up, because I think there's a series of books that this was based off of.
Yeah, exactly.
So, and then
the Wingman for Netflix. We really sold you, Al.
I don't know if it was, again, because maybe my
Netflix out here doing good work.
Expectations went down so low, but like even her talking to the camera didn't bother me. like when she would do it, like, I was like, all right, even if she like looked at it, like when she liked the guy and she gave the look at the screen, I was like, okay, I get it. But I don't know if y'all have Apple
Plus. I get it.
Cute.
They do that.
But check out Tehran on Apple Plus. I don't know if y'all got it like as part of maybe for getting a new phone or something. Tehran. It's a new show. It just came out on Friday on Apple Plus, Apple's TV streaming service. You're going to have patience. If you're not someone that can watch a movie that's mostly subtitled, don't watch it, because the majority of the show is in Tehran in Iran. So most of it is Persian, and the character herself is Israeli. So, you know, she's speaking her language. So the movie very rarely even has any English spoken in it. But it's very, from what I've seen so far, it's very well acted. I'm into those kinds of movies or shows. So it's like a kind of a Jason Bourne type situation. She's a hacker that was went in to do a job. The job goes bad, and now it's all of the repercussions of that. But what I'm finding more interesting of the show is, again, it's not set in America. It's not set in a natively English-speaking country. But you're getting to see a different culture, but you're also getting to see how similar the cultures are. Like even the way the family bonds are, the way this is, the way the government is towards its people. you just get to see that, listen, maybe we're not as different as we try to make ourselves out to be, you know, just because they're from there doesn't mean, you know, you don't have as much in common with them as you think you do. So
yeah,
I'm enjoying that aspect of it, but like, yeah, but like I said, it's very well acted. Go watch the movie. Just be expected to do a lot of reading while you watch it.
All right, cool, man. And B, man, close us out, doggy. What you been watching and what's been on the docket for you, man?
So I watched Antebellum this week, and I would say don't rush to see it, but I want people to make up their own minds on this one because I was very confused watching it, not by the story. Like, the story is very clear. This is obviously a movie. We talked about this a couple times now. This is a movie that suffers from its time slot. This movie is an hour and 45 minutes, and I think I would have liked for it to be two to two and a half hours.
So you wanted, like, a little bit more time to get into it.
I wanted it to be longer because this movie sets itself, for those who, you know, who haven't kind of seen or know about it, it's kind of setting itself up as a, like, Civil War-based movie. So, you know, in slavery times. And the treatment of African Americans. And then they have, like, a kind of a present tense of the movie. And then there's a twist in the movie. But the problem is the twist comes at a point where you think you're early in the movie and it's the end of the movie. And the twist doesn't really have that much time to build for you because they didn't give enough story to that Civil War time and then enough story to the present time to make that twist really feel powerful enough. Like, there's the end of the movie is a really powerful moment, and it makes the twist worth it, but you're like, I would have been so much more invested if there was more story for both parts of this movie. And the twist gets you because, like, the twist gets you because there's a part where they kind of go back and forth in the times, and the twist comes and you're like, oh shit, I'm like, all right, like, I didn't see that coming. And then it's like, all right, I just wish there was more to make that twist really hit its mark.
Gotcha. See, so, now you just sold the movie to me because now I'm interested in seeing the movie,
because, like, I'm gonna be honest, you're gonna see this movie and you'll be like, it was okay. You know, I honestly would give it, like, on a, like, the Rotten Tomatoes give it 55%, and I agree. Why? Because there needed to be way more story. The twist is cool, and it makes you want to, like, really kind of, like, look back at what points in this movie, like, you know, maybe I didn't catch this twist coming, kind of a thing.
Right.
It needed so much more story.
Gotcha.
I needed a 2.5 hour movie where we had, like, the devil, like, around or whatever the heck the movie
devil
was.
Devil all the time.
Depression all the time, you know, like, that was 2.5 hours.
Spoke about that.
Like, 2.5 hours of that hurt me. Like, maybe a little less on that front. This movie, I needed 2.5 hours for it.
Gotcha. All right,
and
man.
And then I've been watching a lot of anime.
Oh,
you don't say.
Food Wars, Haikyuu, which is a volleyball-based anime, which is very interesting.
Volleyball anime?
It's so funny. Like, anime has gone, like, so vast in the last decade where it's not just about fantasy anymore. It's not about, like, you know, the quest and the this and that and superpowers and all that. They literally have an anime called Food Wars, which is about kids who are chefs competing against other chefs. And, like, the explanation of the food process and why they did so. It's so funny because you think you're watching, like, Chopped, and it's anime, and it's hilarious. But then, like, I'm watching this show, Haikyuu, which is a volleyball anime, literally a volleyball high school in Japan versus other, like, volleyball high schools in Japan. And it's like, all right, but it's so entertaining. Like, it's so cool.
Oh, my God.
So funny. Recommend, man. Definitely recommend both of those, Food Wars and Haikyuu.
Oh, man. Awesome, man. Oh, well, listen, guys, we thank you guys for watching and listening. And we thank you guys for especially the four of us here. I thank the three of you for being part of the podcast and giving us those recommendations and telling people what they should watch or what they should think about not watching. It was always a good thing, especially during this time where people are looking for things to do and things to watch. So I appreciate the three of you guys there. And yeah, man, listen, that's going to be our podcast for this week. We'll be back next week with more news and more information because there ain't no movies.
Oh, my God.
We're doing our best, man. Netflix ain't holding me down, man. Oh, man. But look, if there's any kind of topics out there you got us, you know, out there listening, want us to talk about or give us our opinion or give our opinions on anything, just email us at therealfanreview@gmail.com or leave a note again on the bottom of our YouTube little comment section there. You can find us on Instagram, Facebook, and Twitter. And guys, we thank you as always for listening. So coming out of Long Island, New York, we got my boy Sanj.
Have a good night, everybody. Stay safe.
We got my brother B.
Auf Wiedersehen.
And we got our man in the chair, Al.
Have a good night, everybody.
And myself, Hav, guys. We thank you as always. And we'll catch you on the next one. Till next time.